Hello, good morning everyone, and thank you for joining today's webinar. Today, we are presenting webinar on
Can't
Spiritual Intelligence organized by Applied Science and Humanities Department of Parul Polytechnic Institute, Parul University. The main agenda of this webinar is to construct the capacity to possess a socially relevant purpose in life by understanding self and having a high degree of conscience, compassion and commitment to human value. I, Vaishali Nathwani, would like to introduce today's guest speaker, Dr. Sunita Datta from Guwahati. She is working as assistant professor in the Department of Business Administration, Guwahati University. She is actively engaged in teaching and research and have published books, various articles and papers in international and referred journals. Dr. Datta has presented research papers and delivered lectures in various national and international conferences. She is also devotedly involved in various socio-economic and research institutions in India. Her area of research is behavioral science. And it's a pleasure to welcome you here, ma'am, and you can start with the session.
Thank you so much, Vaishali. It's indeed a very warm welcome and a very good appreciation of my what I call research and academics activities. But although starting up off with in a very as a layman person, I give a warm thankful for to Parul University for giving me an opportunity for sharing you people a brief about my thoughts and views about the today's topic about spiritual intelligence. I thank Hemal especially. So not going into details, let's just start with the webinar's topic about spiritual intelligence.
Sure.
Shall I start? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, fine. Starting first off with spiritual intelligence, let's just see what intelligence is actually. Intelligence, what we have been hearing about, or we often know, and everybody knows what intelligence is. What we call is IQ. The intelligence study and the research have been popped up or have been started off in early 90s, and where the various psychologists and various kind of researchers who have a quest and curious to kind of study the concept of intelligence of human mind, of human brain, came up with different kind of what you call psychological tests or to check intelligence. And for them, or according to the entire research analysis, we can say intelligence is the it's a ability to think rationally, to talk meaningfully, to act with a purpose, to act purposefully, to take a specific decision, to take or to take some kind of proper decision of a situation, of our circumstances, or anything which deals with some uncertainties. So likewise, in my slides I have created some kind of definitions. Like intelligence has been defined in many ways, like the capacity to logic. We as human being, the Homo sapiens sapiens, we have the ability to reason. That makes us a different among the animals. We have the ability to think, to rational. We have the ability to think what is right and what is wrong and take a decision. That is the capacity of logic, the capacity of understanding, the capacity of understanding the situation, the capacity of the pros and cons of a situation, of our circumstances, the self-awareness. We have to, we as human beings, we have the self-awareness. If I am a person, a professional, if I am a person who are good in numbers, who I am a mathematician, I am good in numericals, I am good in, I can do a lot of calculations, I am good in technology, then I can do some kind of, I'm good in machinery, I can tackle the softwares. I'm good in IT, or I'm a painter, or I'm an actress. You know, there's this kind of, you know, you have that ability, your self-awareness, you know your capability, you know your basic skill. So intelligence is all about your skill, your capacity, your intellectuality about a specific field. You know, you aware and you try to run, or you try to modify yourself towards this field. And when you identify your self-awareness that you are an artist, or you are a teacher, or you are a doctor, or you are a kind of engineer, then you have the capacity to learn through that process, which we see that, you know, the educational system, we complete our class 10, our 12, and then we go for some professionals, right? In certain kind of, towards certain kind of goals, our mission. Then we have the capacity of emotional knowledge. We are human beings, obviously. We have emotion. We have emotions. When there is uncertainties, like we are scared, like this pandemic or this epidemic of COVID-19, we are scared. We are fear. We are taking precautionary measures. So we as human beings, unlike the animals, like we have the capacity to show our emotions and to react and adapt to a situation as per to maintain the safety protocols as given by the standard operating procedure, the SOP put forwarded by the government. Then comes the reasoning. I have already told you the logic, you know, the reasoning power to act how the situation demands, the reasoning power to think, you know, the reasoning power to think as what is right and what is wrong, and then planning. Like in COVID situation, when we go out, we maintain the safety protocols. We wear a hand glove, or we take a hand sanitizer. We wear a double mask, because nowadays I see that the strands of COVID have been, like, you know, kind of it has been double mutated. So, you know, the precautions or safety measures which has been put forward in 2020 have been upgraded to the you know, you have to wear double-stranded mask because the strand is very strong. So, you know, we have the planning, and as per we create the situation as per, because we as human, we have the capacity to create, unlike the animals. And then we have the problem solving. How the problem solving, like I'm thinking practically, you know, we as humans, we are trying to invent the medicines, the vaccines for this COVID. Now, so for any kind of circumstances, we as humans, we always find some kind of problem solving. So proceed to the next slide. So going to the, you know, kind of like, you know, going to the intelligence or IQ, we say, it is like, you know, it started in 20th centuries. And, you know, the psychologists have discovered a lot of ways to measure the intelligence. Next slide, please. So this IQ have been, you know, Aristotle, he has defined this IQ as the, you know, the rational animal, because, you know, we as human, I have already told you earlier, you know, a few minutes ago, that we as humans, we are Homo sapiens, and we have the capacity to reason and logic. We have the capacity to, you know, think, to question, to have that, we have the curiosity, that why, and to that curiosity or quest, or to that questions, we have the tendency, or we have that kind of capacity to, you know, to answer or look forward the answer. That's why we have so much of researchers, we have so much of, you know, scientists who have coming up with a lot of inventions and discoveries. So, you know, the great thinker, the great management guru Aristotle, he have defined the intelligent quotient, that is the intelligence or the IQ, you can see, as the rational animal. Next. So overall, I've already told you that intelligence is the overall capacity to think rationally, to act purposefully, and to deal effectively with one's environment as per the situation demands. Right now, obviously, you know, stepping out of the house, you know, I'm taking the most relevant and practical example to, like, you know, to define or to kind of describe this intelligence, because we as humans, we are, you know, we have seen every day, you know, people dying of COVID-19. We have seen every day, you know, lakhs of people affected by COVID positive, and like the Indian government have been trying harder and hardest to provide with the maximum of medical facilities. But since the population of India is very, you know, it's very large, and so it's very difficult to, you know, difficult to control. But however, like, you know, the frontline workers, the medical practitioners or the policemen or the frontline workers are trying their level hard, as well as the general public. So, you know, as per the environment, obviously, because of this pandemic, even a kid, you know, even a 3-year-old kid or 4-year-old kid knows what is COVID right now, because that person, like, you know, since, like, you know, going to the background of psychology, and I'll just take you maybe in humanities, nobody is like not related that much to psychology, but I'll just try to pinpoint, like, you know, Erikson, you know, he have point out some 8 stages of psychological personality development, where he stated that, you know, a person develop its personality at a very tender age, which is through his nurturing and through his, like, you know, upbringing. So if a person, like, you know, if he is brought to an environment and the way he nurtured and the way the circumstances, like, you know, compels it or him or her to, you know, behave, or what he hears, he or she, the infant, you know, develops through those roots or through those phases, what the parents or what the situation or what the society or environment, you know, difficult kind of economic, not going into details, a lot of factors, effects. So, you know, for, like, you know, for this situation or for a person, intelligence is, like, you know, first I would say it's the way to think rationally, then to act purposefully, to talk meaningfully, to deal effectively with one's environment, to deal effectively with your peers, your colleagues, with your friends, with society and everything, and to take a decision if situation answering these demands. Next slide. So in progressive, you know, there are 3 kinds of intelligence. What we call as intelligence, we say as quotient. That's why we use that Q. That is quotient, okay? So next slide. So the 3 Qs are intelligent quotients, your emotional quotient and emotional spiritual quotient. The intelligent quotient, we are in quotient, we can address as intelligence also. Next slide. So there are 3 types of intelligence. Intellectual, that is your intelligent, then your emotional, then your spiritual. Next. So we have already talked about intelligence. Next slide. Yeah. So we have already talked about intelligence. Okay. There are 3 types of intelligence. One is your IQ, intelligent quotient. One is your IQ. Second was one is your emotional intelligence, what we call as EQ or emotional quotient. And the third one is your spiritual quotient. So in here, you can see in the diagram, you see that human brain, where the left side, where it is marked as red, is written as like IQ, that is the intellectual intelligence, that is the IQ. That means, you know, all the, you know, kind of in the knowledge, the awareness, you know, everything comes on your, you know, your talent, everything comes on your, you know, on the left side of your brain. And, you know, the emotions, how you react to the situations, your fear, your scared, your happiness, your sorrow, your grief, your disgust, you know, blah, blah. These kind of comes in your, comes from your, you know, this kind of emotions pops up from your, you know, from your right brain, according to neuroscience. But the spiritual intelligence, it covers the entire brain, you know, it covers the, your intelligence, intellectual quotient, as well as your emotional quotient. So we'll go into details. This is a brief, like, you know, kind of setup which I have shown you, that left side is your, you know, IQ, The right side is your EQ, that is the emotional part, emotional intelligence, your right brain. And the overall part is the whole brain comes up with your spiritual intelligence. Next. So, okay, we'll skip this. We have already talked about intelligence, intelligent quotient, which solves logical and yeah. So we have already skipped this. So we know that higher, you know, we have always seen that higher, how, like, you know, higher the IQ, higher is their intelligence. We always say, isn't it? We always say that the person has got the highest caliber or highest skill. He developed a software. He developed a kind of like bulb. You know, he discovered a theory. He discovered an approach. He discovered a theorem. He discovered a kind of, you know, an analysis or a formula, or he discovered, like, you know, the AI, the artificial intelligence is now being developed, like, you know, so he developed some kind of robot. So, you know, we say that the person is very intelligent. You know, the higher is the you know, person's IQ, we say that higher is the intelligence. It's only IQ, okay? So we need to, you know, we need to always, when we say about intelligence, we always need to be very focused, and we need to be very kind of, we need to be very particular about what we talk about. It's, if we talk about IQ or intelligence, we are thinking of, we are talking only about of his left side of the brain, okay? We are not, we are talking only about his knowledge and skill, okay? Next. So then comes, you know, the progressive understanding and function of intelligence led to an understanding of emotional quotient. So, you know, the great management thinker, the great guru, Daniel Goleman, he discovered the emotional quotient. This emotional quotient, from the word emotional, we say that it deals with emotions totally, you know. We have, like, you know, emotional intelligence or emotional quotient. We have that intelligence. We know that we are intelligent, but to deal with emotion is a very strong, you know, what you call, it's a very, you should be very strong enough to, you know, control your mind, to control your body, soul and spirit, so that you can, you know, control and you can be emotionally empowered, or you can be emotionally modified. Like, I would explain you. So if we, what are kind of emotions? Like, what are the emotions? The emotions are, we can say that we have, when situations like goes out of our hand, you know, then we get scared or we panic. When we achieve something, or when there is a glory, or when you are successful, we are happy. When you have a sudden loss, or when you have a kind of disease, or when you have kind of, you know, anything, like, you know, which make you sad, it makes you sad, right? When you are, like, you know, when you saw now this pandemic has made us scared, it made us fear. When we hear some, you know, sudden demise in the family, or sudden demise of our close relatives or our friends, we are at shock, we are at surprise. When your friends or your anyone plans a surprise, you know, plans you a party, a birthday party, or any kind of, you know, party, then your expression is your surprise. So there are different kinds of emotions, you know, which deals with every individual's, you know, when you look at the people who are in the streets, who are poor, who doesn't have the basic amenities to avail, you know, the street livers, or, you know, the people who live below the poverty line, you know, when they have their food, you know, they have that kind of feeling. They have, you know, that kind of sad face, you know. Those kind of emotions deal with, you know, the emotional intelligence. You are, like, you know, you are the boss of the organization. You are the leader of the organization. You know, the people who have a high EQ, the emotional intelligence, you know, they are the leaders. You are, you know, you have the kind of ability, you have the kind of skill to discover a software, but you need emotions, you need strategies, you know, to deal with the people to deal with the manpower, to deal with the human resource. And you can control the machine, you can control a computer, you can control a mobile, you can control any technology, a big machinery, but you cannot control a human mind. So to control a human mind, you have to be very emotionally intelligent. You have to understand the emotions of yours, as well as you have to understand the emotions of others, you know. And if you're intelligent, I'm talking about an IQ, you can lead a team. But if you are higher at EQ, then you can lead. You can be a leader, you know. You have to understand the entire employer's feelings, you know. There are organizations, there are firm, or you can see the vote bank, and or you can see big industries, you know. They always see the emotions. That's why we have in corporate sector or big industrial units, we have this kind of, you know, trade unions. You know why we have the trade unions? We have this kind of panels where we go for industrial disputes, where we go for negotiations and bargainings. Why? Because you know, you also say, I also say, and we come to a conclusion. So when the person thinks that, you know, my manpower or my team has these kind of problems and I'm willing to compromise, and you know, it's a both-sided feeling, then you become a leader. A leader, you know, to the person who has got the higher leadership, if he has got some kind of negative emotions, like he's very arrogant, or he has got some negative attitude, he's very proud, or he has got some anger, he have got, you know, all kind of negative emotions, do you think that will pop up to become a good leader? No. You know, to become a good leader, you need to have always the, you know, kind of compromising or adjusting situations when the uncertainties demands. This is all about emotional intelligence. We'll just see some kind of emotions in the next slides. These next slides. So yeah. So let's see a general definition. It gives us awareness of our own as well as the others' feelings and emotions. I would say that we are human. We are humans, right? So we have the ability to feel the others' feeling, right? You know, and someone is coming, and you know, they are just saying, you're sharing their problems. They're sharing their sorrows. They're sharing their grief, or you know, their happiness or their excitement. Any kind of, we as humans will say that, yeah, that person is actually happy or sad. So we have that awareness. We have the ability to aware, make ourselves the self, you know, awareness, self-awareness of how we as a person can feel, and we can define our emotions. Likewise, like the others, like we say that when we talk about personality, you know, I often come up with some of my lectures when I ask people, or like, you know, that how do you define your personality? Ma'am, I'm a very short-tempered person, or ma'am, I'm a very aggressive person. You know, that person, you know, those, you know, you have the, like, no, the Johari window in psychology. We always know that we know some part of personality traits, that we are arrogant, or we are humble, or we are generous, or we are very short-tempered, we are friendly. So likewise, we know we have that, you know, awareness of self, as well as we can define that this person is selfish, or he is self-centered, or she is self-centered, or she is, like, you know, arrogant, or she shows attitude. So this is the kind of emotional intelligence which one should, like, cultivate or develop, you know, through your own kind of practices. Next slide. So it's the array of skills that influences one's ability to succeed in with co-environmental demands and pressure. Suppose, I'll give you an example. Like, you know, you are a new recruit in an organization, in a very rigid corporate organization, where, you know, the boss always demands some kind of, you know, benchmark, some kind of, you know, targets, where, you know, every day you have that push factor from your colleagues, from your peers, that, you know, this person has already reached this, you have to push it more harder, you know, and some way or the other, you have those kind of gossip, those politics in the office. You know, we know that politics is everywhere, be at home or be it an office, be it in the environment or everywhere. So, you know, at one point of time, you know, you see, you have to have that ability to cope up, or you have to have that ability to control your emotions, rather showing your anger or grief. Because if you show your anger or grief in that particular situation, it will be at loss for yourself, you know. So in that case, you have to master your brain to tackle it in a very clever way and a very smarter way, how to deal with it. Like, you know, when we go for like audits for performance appraisals, we always see that, you know, the boss, or you can say the senior executives, the supervisors, when they give ratings or ranking for their subordinates, they always talking about some, not everyone, you know, a small percentage, they always go for biasness. You know, if you are of same caste, if you are of same religion, if you are of same community, of or of same background, you know, they see some kind of, you know, stereotype thinking, rather that you are workaholic, right? Rather what amount of hard work you are giving, rather your efficiency or your skills, you know. Through that, they never judge you, or they never rate you through those criteria. Rather, like, you know, if you're absent for a few days, why you're absent? Because you have got a certain uncertainties, or you had a certain loss, you know, a certain debt or whatever, marriage or anything, you know. So for that, you know, the supervisor, they judge you, you know, that person is irregular, like for a few days. The recent behavior, or the you had a kind of argument. So in that case, you know, there are some kind of biasness. So in that case, you know, the emotional intelligence makes you demand, you know, makes your person, a person's ability to demand whether to act rationally through that situation, to act rationally, what I mean, to act correctly in that situation or not. Because if he won't act, like, you know, if he act through some politics or through that system politics, every system has got some their own politics or whatever, in that case, he'll be unethical to this, to its like kind of ratings. So you, in emotional intelligence, you have to be very much strong enough to understand yourself, to understand your peers, to understand the surroundings. Next slide. So we know that in IQ have been, like, you know, studied by Aristotle as rational human being, and then, you know, the research have not stopped. We are human beings. We have already told you, I've already told you that there are, like, you know, we have always the quest, the curiosity of learning and understanding, the curiosity of hunting. So we popped up to learn for emotional intelligence, which is of equal importance. Next. Okay, next. So these are some kind of emotions. You can see this lady's face. She looks angry. I don't know. I find her angry, but she looks anger. This is a kind of emotion. Next. Fear. So this person is you know, scared of something, so he has got that emotions of fear. So, you know, emotionally, when we as Hindi individuals, like, we always have that kind of we always read, you know, we can read people's mind, that whether, okay, something is wrong with her or wrong with him, she looks sad or he looks sad. So this kind of emotion we can read. So we say the face is the index of mind. So here we can see that this person is fear. He's in fear. Next. Disgust. Next. Surprise. Yeah, next. Not going into detail because of happy. Yeah, next. So I think we'll be happy once the COVID-19 will be reduced. I know it will not reduce, but where we will be like, quit, we'll be like quitting off this marks and those, the sorrow. Next. So the emotional intelligence, it's been observed that a person's overpowered by emotions fail to act intelligently and rationally, obviously. So what it means that when a person is like overpowered with its emotions, he loses its state of mind. He acts. We often find that people who, people who always engage in some kind of some substances like alcohol, drugs or etc. When we go for some rehabs, when we see the rehabilitation centers, we always, okay, there are certain percentage of people who are like who take it for fun or pleasure or whatever. But there are certain people who engage in this kind of substances. Why? Because they cannot deal with their emotions. They doesn't have that strength to cope up with that kind of situations as per it demands. Okay, so what the topic today is, the spiritual, I'll talk it later, I'll discuss it later. This is the thing which a person should have, to overcome it or to develop the human by mind and soul to control your body. Because ultimately, this, when we talk about science, we are human beings and we have got those are physical, biological, and chemical factors which revolves around your body. Everything controls, everything has the control over the mind. If you think that you can control and you can face the situation, you go forward, you face it, and you be prepared of whatever is the worst, or and you act rationally, So in emotional intelligence, what we see in enterprises or in big business firms or in organization, we see that people are like, in big engineering institutes, like, we see that there are a lot of suicidal cases of the students. Why? Because they cannot handle the pressure. In corporate sector, we see that there is a huge labor turnover. Why? Because they cannot handle the pressure as well as their personal pressure, the family pressure. So we need to have that balance. We need to develop that skill. I know it's not easy when you are in a situation, it's very difficult, but we need to make up our mind because everything is, it's in the mind. I have already told you, the left side is the intelligent, the right side is the emotional, and the entire part is the emotion, the spiritual. It is in our hand how we control the brain, how we control our mind to face it. So this actually act us, it actually rule us, or it actually direct us to go for or to take such drastic decision like physical abuses. So we need to be very emotionally strong. We see there are people, who are like in workplaces where the women are not being given those kind of equality like the male. I'm not talking about the gender inequality or feminism right now, but we see that a glass ceiling concept where the family barriers, the societal barriers, the economic, the political, a lot of barriers hampers the women, especially in India, to the re to go for top, to rise. So that's why we have the glass ceiling concept. So in this case, in this case where we are bounded, that we have these obligations, we have these obligations, we have, one, two, three, four, we have to make a balance. So likewise, in those part of, at that point, at that particular phase, a person gives up. A person, like, he just like quits. So in that case, you have to be very strong enough to cope up. Because in an enterprise or in a corporate world, there will be politics, there will be gossip, there will be a lot of things, but you have to be very strong enough to deal with it. You don't have to take it with your heart. You think with your mind, you have to challenge it. You don't show it over face. You don't show you don't show your emotions, but you have to go for it. You have to do your hard work. You have to believe your believe God, you know, that is about spirituality. You have to develop the divine feeling. So this is all about emotional intelligence. Let's go for that. The next. So obviously, through further progress of intelligence and EQ, we develop the third Q, that is the spiritual quotient. So let's start with, let's see what spiritual intelligence is. Okay, so we have already discussed, that the human intelligence, is the ultimate form of intelligence in today's world. We have the capacity to take our intelligence, to take our skills, and we have to take our emotions as well. And you have to develop the spirituality, the spiritual intelligence to live in this life. Because in this life, we have to be, we have to be balanced. There are in life, we see that in life, we are like a clown, or we can say that we are this life is a kind of circus. It's a kind of, we are like jokers. We have like five balls in our hand. You see that five balls, jingling like five balls, who doesn't, which the joker, which the clown, it jingles, but it doesn't fall in the ground. So we have that five balls, the five balls. Number one, it's the work. It's the work. Number two is the health. Okay. Number three is your, it's your family. Number four is your friends. Number five is your spirit. So these five balls, you need to have that, to have a balancing life, you need to have the balancing of these balls. If one falls, you should know the kind of strategy how to deal with it. So out of these five balls, which I have stated, number one is your work. Number two is the family. Number two is your health. Number three is your family. Number four is your friends, and number five is your spirit. So out of these five, work, your professional life is like a rubber. It falls off. If you quit your job, you'll have a lot of opportunities. You leave that ball, you leave the work ball, the first jingling ball, you drop it, but it will bounce back. You'll have a lot of opportunities. You can always gear yourself up. You can always gear your you took a break because of this pandemic. Suppose you left your job, your business has got some loss, but you can always gear yourself up because there are opportunities. You can manage capitals, but if your family, but the other rest of the four, your family, your health, your friend, your spirit, if it's lost, they are like glasses. If it falls down, either it will break, either it will crack, or either it will reshape, but it will never regain the shape like it was before. But for your work life, you might have much better opportunities than you had like before. But for your family, if it broke, you have, those kind of distances, those kind of disputes, those kind of difference in the family, and because you had some kind of problems in your health issues. Once it's dropped up, it's very difficult to regain. Likewise, the friends. We always say the friends are the ones, a friend in need is a friend indeed. We think that, we take things, friends, for granted. But this human mind, these relationships are very fragile. It's very, what do you call it? It's very sensitive. So you need to balance those things. Then comes your spirit. You know, sometimes you see that, yeah, you can, but your spirit is very low. You don't have that kind of active, you don't have that kind of energy. We always go for motivational classes, we always go for some kind of positivity counseling, psychological counseling. Why? Because our spirit is low. We fall in somewhere where there is nothing, where we cannot control ourselves, we cannot control the situations. And when we can't control your situations, we go for some psychological counselors. So in those cases, it's very, it's very important to maintain these five balls of life. You live like a human and you act like a professional, but it's very important you act like a human being, as a rational person. As a rational person, what I mean, the power to reason, the power to logic, to power to understand what is right and what is wrong. Not involving in politics, having your own ethics, having your own values, having your own morals, to revert back, to take a decision, to develop your personality. That is your, what you call, the spiritual intelligence. Next. So this spiritual intelligence was like first put forwarded by Dana Zohar along with his colleague Ian Marshall, and they forwarded they published a book, The Emotional Intelligence, The Ultimate Intelligence. Dana have first put forward this emotional intelligence. So she and along with her colleague have put forward certain parameters, and they dealt with some very detailed study of the human mind. Where you can read. You can just note down the book's name, The Spiritual Intelligence, The Ultimate Intelligence by Dana Zohar and Ian Marshall. Next slide. So let's see. So this slide I have made it for the students. I think they like it. So let's see some of the three examples of the three intelligence or quotients. Let's see. Next slide. Yeah. Talking about intelligence, we can take the examples of computer, where the rules are, where the rules can follow without follow them, without making. And then next slide. Next slide. Yeah, EQ. When we say that, when it is animal, it's animals. It's like the animals which we find that, they have the rational thinking. When we think about a dog, he or she thinks that, we see that the dog, when the a pet dog, whoever has a pet dog, he or she always sees that the person, the owner, the Malik comes and he greeted it with great love, with great care, and they say that it's you feel loved. So this animals, we are the emotionals, they understand the emotions. You give birth to every food to an animal, at 8, at 8 p.m. or 8 a.m., 8 a.m., 8 p.m., 8 a.m., 8 p.m. Whenever they see you, the animals see you, they always develop an emotion. Okay, this person with this face gives us the food, when we are hungry, this person, he develops it emotions, When you show love to that animal, whenever you come up, you show love, he or she, the animal will show love reciprocally, they'll show that, yeah, this person will show love. If a person, shows anger, they just betray it. The animals doesn't, as per the situation demands, it doesn't show. When we talk about the street dogs, we always say that, when you give some biscuits or some rotis or some kind of food, you always see that, okay, this person, they hunt for some emotions. So these animals, they know emotions as per they see, as per they act, as per they feel. Okay, next. The example of spiritual intelligence. So what I'm trying to say is that, the spiritual intelligence is the intelligence, is the spiritual quotient is the ultimate form of intelligence, of both the intelligence as well as the intelligence as well as their emotions part. They have the capacity to understand. They have the capacity to understand the emotions as well as to think and act rationally through their brain. That is a part of spiritual intelligence. You should have that knowledge, you should have that power to make yourself free from all the worldly pleasures, all the worldly relationships, be it socially, be it environment, be it your personally, and devote yourself. You don't have, you leave up your expectations, you leave up your, those kind of negative emotions like anger, greed, envy, jealousy. You have to think that the goodness of others, you have to think about the goodness of others, you have to think about the benefits of others. In that way, you have to accomplish yourself in this regard. Next slide. Neither animals nor computers can ask why we have these rules or situations. Next slide. So this spiritual intelligence allows humans to be creative, to seek answers to fundamental questions, play an infant. Obviously, we as human beings, we always have this kind of, we have this kind of spirituality, we have this kind of inquisitiveness or curiosity to ask why it happened, how it happened, when it will happen, or what is the cause. Unlike the animals, we don't doesn't have those kind of, like the rational, we have those kind of rational brain, we have those kind of rational thinking that why this kind of thinking happened. So in this regard, we as humans, we have to play the game till the death. We have to cultivate, we have to develop those skills. You have to develop the curiosity that what happened, why it happened, and how it happened, and if it happened, how we have to deal it. We have to develop that attitude of calmness, that attitude of, cool, keeping cool, that attitude of keeping patient, that attitude of, that anger management, so that we have to think spirituality, spiritually, we have to think divinely. In Bhagavad Gita, they say that, you think each and every living being as Brahma. You think that every human being every human being resides God. You have you when you think that every human being, there is a soul resides God, be it a, a dhobi wala, or a, what do you call a security guard, or a servant, or a maid, or a politician, or a director. Every soul resides God. And when you see that, when every soul resides God, you cannot hurt that people, that person. And be it animal, be it a plant, be it any living beings. And when you see and when you feel that this particular living being, God resides, you kind of, develop that kind of respect, you develop that kind of feeling, and that is your spiritual intelligence. Next. It's a soul's intelligence. I have told you, you have to think that it is a person's soul that feels what a person's feels, what a person or any living being feels. He or she should feel that what other persons feel. When you feel that you have seen that your employer or your employee or your boss or your subordinate, so your supervisor is having some kind of problem, or maybe that anger is because of his or her own personal problems, You should act rationally in that case. You have to take it calmly. You have to deal that person calmly. You have to think that this person has got some personal grief or some personal problems in his or her life. So in that case, you have to develop an intelligence to make that situation or things, or take the situation very calmly and handle it in a very calm way. You know, next. So how I take a person's rationally is that if you climb a ladder, next, and at the end of the day, you say that your brain says that, yeah, that is not the correct ladder you have climbed. You have taken the wrong steps of the building. You have to go to the, you know, supposed to the left side of the building, and you went to the right side of the building. In that case, what you felt, your brain says that you have climbed to the left side of the building. So, you know, the act, you know, that you have done something wrong, that makes you a human. That makes you spiritually active, that you have the reasoning power of controlling your intelligence as well as your reasoning power, that you have taken the wrong steps and you have climbed the wrong steps, wrong direction, and your wrong steps, and your goal is wrong. That makes the emotional intelligence as well as the intelligence. So that is a spiritual intelligence. You know, it controls your brain. Next. So this is the intelligence that connects to the wisdom of bygone ages beyond the ego or conscious mind. So in emotional intelligence, you have this kind of connection between wisdom. You have that kind of wisdom brain, and we have seen through our like ages, we have seen our gurus, you know, we have seen that our ancient gurus, that we have always developed the wisdom to how to control and calm our mind. So that is a connection of the spiritual intelligence. Next. So according to Dana Zohar and Ian Marshall, you know, spiritual intelligence is the intelligence with which we address and solve problems of meaning and value, the intelligence with which we can place our actions and our lives in a wider, richer meaning, giving context, the intelligence with which we can assess that one course of actions or one life path is more meaningful than another. According to Dana Zohar and Ian Marshall, you know, I have already told you, they studied around 3,000 people. They studied 3,000 people, and this 3,000 people, they have, you need to, you know, understand how this 3,000 people in different roles, you know, a role as a professional, a role as a kind of a family person, a role as a role for the society, a role as a friend, a role as a father, a role as a wife, a role as a sister or brother, a role as a, you know, a supervisor, a role as, you know, etc., a role as a kind of customer, a role as a an audience, a role as a public, a role as a government, a role as a speaker, a role as a student, a role as, you know, according to Dana Zohar and Ian Marshall, they studied the spiritual intelligence, because spirituality is not about only professionalism or human. It's covering the entire sphere. It's a study of the entire roles, all the roles of a person dealing with the everyday life, you know, as a father, as a brother, as a husband, as a son, as a professional, as a director, as a supervisor, as a subordinate, as a friend, as a subordinate, all spheres. And he says that, you know, to master it or to deal it with patience is what spirituality is, spiritual intelligence is. It's a combination of your intelligence as well as controlling your emotions and dealing it in a rational way. It defines as your spiritual intelligence. Next. I have already told you the book. So they leave that, they put forward that the spirituality, spiritual intelligence is a we know everybody is materialistic. We deal with material world. Whatever is in our hand, we always say that, widow doesn't do anything for, we always see that, she has got that, they have got this. We are very materialistic. We see the material aspect of a person's life. He has got Audi, BMW, this kind of jobs, this, blah, blah. We always think, always see the, the socioeconomic factors for to judge a person. And we are very selfish in that case. We are very inhuman. We doesn't look forward for emotions, or we doesn't see concern the humanity. And thus we lack the meaning of life. We fall in that kind of, what do you call, we fall in that kind of category where people are very selfish, where people are very self-centered. Sorry to keep you all. Sorry to keep you all awake. Then next question. Next. So we say that with low IQ we can win. We can win the nut of success, but we can crack open if it is empty. We see that we attain success. We attain success. Yeah, we reach to a definite acorn of life, but we see that we have no one in our hands. We have no one. We don't have friends, we don't have family, we don't have anything in our life. And when we don't have anything in our life, the success without our family, friends, relatives, or without any thing, it's a success meaningless. So we need to be spiritually very much intelligent and active to crack or to understand or to deal smartly with the importance and the dimensions of spiritual intelligence, and then find out how to deal with it. Next. Yeah, human beings are essentially spiritual characters driven by the need to ask the fundamental questions. I have been saying that, yes, we are human beings, and we have that rational mind. We have that rational thinking that why we have the rational thinking as why we had that, why we did that, who did that, how they did that. So, to answer this question is very important. It is very, very, it is very utmost important, so that we can control the spiritual, the intelligence within ourselves, the personality. We control the spiritual driven personality traits to cope up with the environment. Next. Yeah, these are the who am I. We have to understand before attaining spiritual intelligence, it is very important, we have to be free. In Dana Zohar's book, The Spiritual Intelligence, The Ultimate Intelligence, put forwarded that we need to be very much we need to understand first, we need to be free from the societal bonds. We need to be free from our personal bonds. We need to be free from our family bonds. And we need to ask ourselves that who am I, and what are we doing? Why are we, I was born, and what is the meaning of our life, and what happens after that? If these things happen, and if you are aware, or if you are literally got that understanding about yourself, then you can lead that spiritual intelligence, and you can master your spiritual intelligence activities. So these are the questions, and of course we as human beings, we always answer, or we always have questions like what happened, what will happen after that, why it happened, and what happens after that, and blah blah kind of things. Next. So human life is like a junction. Obviously it's a kind of intervention between the past life. We always hear about the reincarnation. Our grandmother and our mothers or our forefathers always say that, we as people, we always have we have this kind of feelings that this happened. If you leave this kind of life, this thing will happen. If you leave this kind of life, have this thing won't happen. You know, you'll be reborn as human, or you'll be reborn as ant or as animal through our deeds. So if a person suffers, we always say that, you know, maybe this suffering is because of your past life. You know, mere bure karmo, mera past kuch, you know, my past bad life has got some impact in my present life. We always say that. And, you know, why we say that? We always say that maybe, you know, it's a kind of hype, or it's any, you know, it's kind of any kind of false thing. But no, no, there's nothing like that. I'll give you some kind of a book, you know, by next slide. We'll go into the next slide. If we live as a good, you know, spiritual person, a person with good spiritual intelligence will have a very, will live as a human birth, will give birth as a human in our next generation. We always say that if you live like a good human, if you preach, you be ethical, you do, you know, good karmas, then you'll always be reborn as good as a human being. But if you do some kind of bad karmas, or you're with bad sins, you'll be reborn as kind of whatever, animals or whatever. So I have a book, you know, next slide. It's a true story by Dr. Brian Ayers, you know, many life masters, and he's a prominent psychiatrist, and he did some some psychological study with his young patient. Next slide. And he found out, next slide, and he found out that, you know, Catherine, who is that young patient of him, he has been, like, you know, continuously and psychologically dealing with this patient, and who was suffering from some nightmares and chronic anxieties. When his traditional, you know, kind of therapies, where the psychologists use therapies and, you know, some electrical shocks and kind of those things, and medical therapies he used, and he found out that there was not any kind of impact in Catherine. And then when he did some kind of hypnosis, and he found that there is some kind of connections between him and her, you know, Catherine, he found out that there is kind of some spiritual factors, or spiritual what I call legends, or spiritual people who are having entities who are having that kind of connection through her, from her last birth. You know, it's called reincarnation. Not going into details. Next, you people, if you feel like, and if you have time, you can read that book, and then where you can hold a strong kind of understanding about this. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Okay. So now the next, coming to the path to attain higher spiritual intelligence. This is the path of duty. You have to follow your duty. You know, you have to follow what you are and what you have to do. Whether you are in a family, whether you are in a workplace, whether you are with friends, you should always do your duties. You should always, as a person, should have and develop responsibility. You as a student, you have the responsibility to study. You as a citizen of India, you have the responsibility to vote. You as a citizens of you as a person to follow the government rules. Whatever you have to do, your duty, the path that is assigned to you, and the rules and regulations that that has been standard for you in the family, or as a friend, or as in, you know, workplace, or in your own life, you know, as a person, that is very important. We see person dealing with alcoholism, we see person dealing with drugs, we see person who doesn't have a balanced life. We see that they go just randomly without any goals. Why? Because they doesn't have any goal. They doesn't have that discipline in life. So in this, you know, in spiritual intelligence, very important that you do your duties well. whether you don't expect from the others or from the third party or second party or your peers or anyone, but you do your duties. Be that person or that party or that anything, reciprocate in a very bad manner, but you have to do your duty. You have to nurture your part. The nurturing means the part of nurturing should be ethical. It shouldn't be unethical. It shouldn't be bad. It shouldn't be negative. The path of nurturing, the path of doing the duty, it should be very much ethical. It should be divine. It should have those kind of values or morals, those kind of righteousness, so that you can be the examples for the future. You can set the footprints for your, you know, next generations. You can be the trendsetter, the part of nurturing, the part of knowledge. For the part of knowledge, you should read, you should understand, you should understand the human brain, you should read, you should practice exercises, you should practice. A lot of articles are there, a lot of books are there. You should, you know, try to cultivate the knowledge. Then you try to develop the part of personal transformation. For how to develop the part of personal transformation? It is not easy. You as a person, I have already told you in, you know, Erikson, you know, there is a psychological study in Erikson 8 stages, where, you know, there are people who are very rigid, who doesn't have want to transform themselves. But if you can't transform, leave it. Because, you know, your self-realization, your self-transformation, your self-understanding comes from your own. No one will have to trigger. You have to. You can trigger it once. You can trigger it twice. You can trigger it maybe 100 times. Because if the person doesn't understand for 101 times, what can you do? It collapses. So the part of transformation, you have to understand. You have to understand your values. You have to understand your ethics. You have to understand everything about the environment, about your peers, about yourself, about your reasoning, about what is right, and then act rationally. That is the part of transformation. It will be hard. The part of brotherhood. Nowadays, we are very selfish. We have to think about others. We have to think about a society. We have to develop, you know, we have to cultivate, you know, the activities. We have to engage yourself in NGOs and do some cultural, you know, some societal activities, some corporate social responsibilities for the society. And the path of a servant leadership rather than leader of a boss. As a boss, I'm a leader. I may be a leader, but I should think that I'm a servant. I should think about my peers. I should think about my subordinates. I should think about my society. I should never be arrogant. I should always think that the other person or the other party or my subordinates has some problems. So in this case, you know, you will attain a higher self, spiritual intelligence. Next. Then the steps to these are the, you know, become aware of where I am now, feel strong that I want to teach. Reflect on what my own center is on and what are my deepest motivation, discover and dissolve obstacles, which I've already covered, explore many possibilities to go forward, commit myself to a path, remain where there are many paths. Next. So now see the benefits to enhance spiritual intelligence. Next. It enables one to live more balanced life. Obviously, you know, when you are spiritually strong, when you're emotionally strong, and when you have a strong intelligence, you might be a person who are very good in mathematics. You're a person who are very good in numericals. You're a person who are very good in machines or softwares. You are a person who are very good in public relations. You have a very good skill of social intelligence. But ultimately, your life is nothing. Your personal life, you have no meaning. You know, when you have a balanced life, you know, when you have a balance factor or balancing in every spheres of life, then you will be satisfied, and then you will be peacefully. You'll be satisfied peacefully when you are satisfied at your workplace, when you are satisfied at your family life, your personal life, your social life, you know, everything. It enables when you, and these things masters when you have, when you're spiritual, when you have that intelligence to master your, or you control your intelligence and use your emotions, and then use both the intelligence quest to master your spiritual intelligence. In that case, you'll have a balanced life. Next. It enables one to affects, manage one's emotions, right? Next. Then it once become more reflective and introspective. Yes. When you have, when you are a very spiritually intelligent person, you will be reflective in your actions. You'll be reflective. You will show your calmness. You will show, you'll be introspective. You will, you know, try to see your entire personality trait. You will see your entire positive and negative emotions. You'll overcome it. You will try to rectify yourself, and you will try to show the positive positive emotions. You will be reflective. And what are the reflective? When you are spiritually mastered, you will always show the positive response, right? So that is a reflection of your personality. Next. It builds in us the capacity to face sufferings and life's ups and downs. So, you know, life is very unpredictable. We have been always dealing with challenges and kind of uncertainties every time, every day. It's a kind of everyday challenge and everyday war for us. Like as of now in this COVID pandemic, it's like everyday war dealing with this COVID-19. But for us, like, you know, we have to face, we have to cope up that emotions. We have to cope up that capacity to deal with the ups and downs of life. There might be some loss. There might be some kind of, or I would say there might be some financial loss, or there might be some human loss, or there might be kind of any kind of loss, any kind of uncertainties. So dealing with it and taking that, you know, that negative drawback, and, you know, squeezing it in into lemon and making it a lemonade and taking it to the acorn of success. That is what spirituality. You take the, you know, failures. We always say that failures are pillars of success. When we take that failure, when we take that, you know, downfall, or when we take and you squeeze it up and make it a lemonade, that makes you the, give you the spark. So we need to cope up, or you develop the capacity to go through the high and lows of the life, because we know that life is not always about the bed of roses. It's about it's a roller coaster ride. You know, it's between the thorns and petals. It between the ups and downs. Next, the reluctance to cause unnecessary harm. Obviously, we should always think that we should always cause a little harm to people. You know, to anyone. We shouldn't be like, you know, animals. We shouldn't be like, you know, animals are also have good emotion. We're not like monster or any kind of negative. We should always cause good, like, you know, good intention and be little good harm. Good, we always should do good to people or to humanity and society. Next. Can place our lives in wider meaning of giving context. Obviously, when we do good, and when we pursue this kind of activities and this kind of you know, virtues and this kind of ethics, and we every day when we inculcate, or when we deal with this kind of activities, then we can say, and then others will, we can be a trendsetter. We always say that what we preach, what we teach. You know, you cannot just teach and teach, but we have to preach. We have to follow. We first have to be an example of ourselves. We have to first do this, then we can teach, so that others can give an example that so and so person has done this, was like this, but now he has been like this, she has been like this. So, you know, we have to place ourselves in a wider meaning concept, devoting ourselves to the environment and the society. Next. Giving us the ability to discriminate between the right and the wrong, a moral sense, not following the politics, not following the political system, the, you know, the rigid the dirty politics. No, you have to be very clean shade. You have to have your own ethics. You have to follow your own positive state of mind and go for it. Next, you have to help control of your anger, your disappointment, your irritation, your fear, your sorrow. Obviously, next. So now we how to enhance the spiritual intelligence. So in the book, The Ultimate Intelligence, Dana Zohar and Ian Marshall have conclusively put forward some 8 major commands to survive in a spiritually dumb culture, because we are in a culture where people are just like, you know, speaking and they are just like doing things, but those are just show offs and those are just kind of, they are not practically or spiritually or emotionally into it. For that, how to survive in this kind of spiritual culture, you don't have to show off. You don't have to show it anything. You just have to know for yourself, your first deepest motive. What is your goal? How to polish yourself? How to polish your society? What are the things you are going to do? Then the highest degree of self-awareness. You have to be self-aware. You know, it is very important that you have to be mentally very, your intelligence, you know, and your IQ should be very strong to understand and to know what will happen and to judge what is right and wrong, rather being influenced and or rather being like, you know, pushed, or rather being just like going to the system of politics. You have to have your own ethics and you have to have your own rational thinking of mind. And that makes you a different individual. Then being responsive to this deep self. Obviously, if you know that this is wrong and you are not responding to that thing, then you are unethical. But if you know that this is going wrong and you're responding to the situation, that is being responsive to the deep self. Because you can cheat or you can lie to everyone, but you cannot lie to yourself. And that makes you spiritually intelligent. A capacity to try, use and transcend difficulties. I have already told you, you should always, you know, take the difficulties and create a difficulties, make it a bombshell and make it yourself. You make the trigger and push factor to uplift yourself and achieve your goal, you know, to make it that, you know, empower yourself, to enlighten yourself. You read books, you go for, you know, some physical exercise, you do yoga, you engage in some positive walk, like, you know, works, you go for some, you read books, you go for some positive walks, you engage in your hobbies, you always go for some, you know, positive factors. Standing against a crowd, we always say that, you know, a person who stands away from the crowd is different, and we always say that different person is always a bad person, but no, that person has got some different motives, yes, but if you see that bad motives are his own choice of life, you can say it's right. Maybe it might be wrong. And in that case, we always have good get some counselors, or we have good some good legal obligations for it. But we always have to set our own. I've always said we have to set our own ethical brain, own ethical values, own ethical morals to stand or go against the system. Reluctant to cause harms, we are humans. And if we are, you know, spiritually intelligent, we will cause little harm to people. Because why? Because we understand people's emotions. We understand people's feelings. Then being spiritually intelligent about religion, not talking much more about religion, because it depends from individual to individual as per their born. Then spirituality intelligent about death. We know our men are mortal. Ultimately, we are born in soil and we have to get born in the soil and we have to be a soil. So there is in we that earthly pleasure, that worldly leisure doesn't matter for us, you know. You know, the Alexander the Great, you know, he always say that, you know, when you bury me, always leave my hands out in the graveyard. Why? Because people should know that the person who conquered America should always got nothing when he died. So we never should have that more Maya, which doesn't have no kind of, you know, kind of greed for any worldly pleasures. Next. So the seven factors of spiritual intelligence is your caring. You have to be caring for your own physical processes. Like you have to be eating. Eating is a very important factor for our physical entity, because you know it's a physical. It's the mind and the brain that controls the physical entity. So we have to be very conscious. We have to eat healthy. And nowadays, because of pandemic, we have to make our immune system strong. We have to eat healthy stuff. Like we have to leave the processed food, you know, the junk food. We have to eat, you know, the fruits, veggies, you know, those kind of Ayurvedas and homely cooked veggies and everything. Then we have.